There is a confluence of pervaded and unpervaded space just underneath Nether Paradise.
You've given us a sample, in my opinion, of the real beauty of our future home.
Presentation is principally the work of David Neupfer, who is the editor of themasteruniverse.org. David has been working on this project long before he asked me to join him in preparing for this presentation. Our title for today's presentation is Understanding Revealed Cosmology Through Visualization, Matching Stellar Observations with Revealed Universe Architecture. David, the platform is now yours.
Yeah, thank you, Margie. That was really nice. Margie spent like 2 to 5 hours a week with me for over 6 months discussing the project. And, you know, she did things that I could never do myself. So I really appreciate her major contribution. But on to the presentation. We have 6 videos to show today, and just a heads up, Margie did expertly voice several of the videos, but there was one that had a different than human voice, and she doesn't always get the pronunciations right. It's just like an accent, computer accent, and you know, I don't get the pronunciations right all the time either, so. Video 1 will be an introduction to the Master Universe model. Video 2 is an interlude video called Trinity to Infinity. And next would be an explainer video called Galactic Coordinates and Absolute Direction. This video will be followed by one that shows the model at work called Respiration and Transmutation. And video 5 is a continuation of the explainer video that's called Coordinating the Coordinates. And video 6 is something of an excursion entitled Traversing Total Space. So let's start by watching the Master Universe model.
The cosmology of the Urantia Papers is presented on such a grand scale that it can be challenging to take in through the narrative alone. With advanced computing power and software, we can more readily, graphically represent revealed concepts and thus more easily comprehend the given descriptions of Paradise Isle, the central universe, space respiration, and force circulations. A new and evolving 3D master universe model can become a framework for scientists and Urantia scholars to build upon by incorporating current and historical astronomical observations. Models, be they of planetary orbits of solar systems, or the three-dimensional structures of the spike proteins, help us understand relationships. We model particles, molecules, structures, planets, galaxies, and even universes. The word model comes from the Latin modulus, which means a measure. In English, the term was first used in the 16th century to note plans for a building. By definition, a model is an informative representation of something.
we present a three-dimensional computer-generated model of revelatory cosmology as described in the Urantia book. Coding the Master Universe Model began in 2019 by David Neufer, editor of the Master Universe Almanac. Revelation students have modeled concepts in their minds to aid with understanding the book's relationships, and they have drawn diagrams on convenient surfaces to illustrate discussion points for each other. Serious scholars have been modeling more complex representations since the book's publication in 1955. The Master Universe model is built from the center outward. At the center is the eternal Isle of Paradise. All other objects, pathways, and conditions surround it. Although the Master Universe model is coded for nearly a million objects, billions more are yet to be included. In addition to illustrating revealed cosmology, the Master Universe model lets us superimpose current and historical astronomical data. We have positioned 3,500 stars. In time, it will be possible to include galaxies, voids, galactic walls, and millions of stars. And the model will change as our understanding grows. Today, we present visualizations from this model. We hope to demonstrate a reasonable method for aligning known stellar observations with revealed universe architecture. First star maps were the stars themselves. The stars served as maps and they helped guide us on our way. Early people did not need astronomical tables and charts filled with measurement data. Humans through time have found pictures in the stars. The first astronomical conventions were agreements among stargazers that a set of lights up there looked a little like something down here. Eventually, though, people did begin listing the stars. Ptolemy of Alexandria became famous for this. In his second century treatise called the Almagest, He cataloged over 1,000 stars and listed their locations and brightness data. Through time, astronomers have created new star charts, each adding to our evolving knowledge about the heavens. By the 20th century, the number of known stars increased dramatically. Whole sky surveys were done by multiple observatories. More powerful telescopes required greater precision to coordinate the ever-growing data streams. By mid-century, difficulties arose due to a lack of consistency in the coordinate systems being used. So the International Astronomical Union defined a very specific coordinate system based on the 21-centimeter atomic hydrogen line for the galactic fundamental plane and a radio source in Sagittarius A for the zero point. This convention is known as the Galactic Coordinate System, or the GCS. This sun-centered system harmonizes evolving knowledge about the placement of sky objects and facilitates theories about distances. The Urantia papers introduced the concept of a paradise-centered absolute direction. Let's take a look at what the authors tell us about the position of paradise, its relation to space, and how the mother force of space indicates the direction of absolute north.
In form, paradise differs from the inhabited space bodies. It is not spherical, it is definitely ellipsoid, being 1/6 longer in the north-south diameter than in the east-west diameter. The central aisle is essentially flat, and the distance from the upper surface to the nether surface is 1/10 that of the east-west diameter. These differences in dimensions, taken in connection with its stationary status and the greater outpressure of force energy at the north end of the aisle, make it possible to establish absolute direction in the master universe. The inner zone of this force center seems to act as a gigantic heart whose pulsations direct currents to the outermost borders of physical space. It directs and modifies force energies but hardly drives them. The reality pressure presence of this primal force is definitely greater at the north end of the paradise center than in the southern regions. This is a uniformly registered difference. The mother force of space seems to flow in at the south and out at the north through the operation of some unknown circulatory system which is concerned with the diffusion of this basic form of force energy. We do not know the actual mechanism of space respiration. We merely observe that all space alternately contracts and expands. This respiration affects both the horizontal extension of pervaded space and the vertical extensions of unpervaded space, which exist in the vast space reservoirs above and below paradise. In attempting to imagine the volume outlines of these space reservoirs, you might think of an hourglass. There is a confluence of pervaded and unpervaded space just underneath Nether Paradise. Both types of space there flow through the transmuting regulation channels, where changes are wrought making pervadable space non-pervadable and vice versa, in the contraction and expansion cycles of the cosmos. We really know very little about the space reservoirs, merely that they exist, and that they seem to counterbalance the space expansion contraction cycles of the universe of universes. The cycles of space respiration extend in each phase for a little more than 1 billion Urantia years. During one phase, the universes expand, during the next, they contract. Pervaded space is now approaching the midpoint of the expanding phase, while unpervaded space nears the midpoint of the contracting phase, and we are informed that the outermost limits of both space extensions are, theoretically, now approximately equidistant from paradise. The unpervaded space reservoirs now extend vertically above upper paradise and below nether paradise, just as far as the pervaded space of the universe extends horizontally outward from peripheral paradise, to and even beyond the fourth outer space level. Paradise is motionless, being the only stationary thing in the universe of universes. The Isle of Paradise has a universe location but no position in space. Space does not exist on any of the surfaces of Paradise. If one looked directly up from the upper surface of Paradise, one would see nothing but unpervaded space going out or coming in, just now, coming in. Space does not touch Paradise, only the quiescent midspace zones come in contact with the central aisle.
The Galactic Coordinate System was established in 1959. It uses the Earth's Sun as its center and is incremented from 0 to 360 degrees. 0 degrees is defined by the position of Sagittarius A. It has specific north and south poles. Absolute direction is described in the Urantia book, published in 1955. It is centered on the Isle of Paradise and employs the cardinal directions north, south, east, and west. From our position, Sagittarius A indicates the direction to Paradise Center. The Galactic Coordinate System and revealed absolute direction share a fundamental plane, but which way is up? The papers provide clues that may help us with the answer. These clues give us reason to suspect that the poles of the GCS must be reversed to align with absolute direction. This reversal is done by rotating stellar positioning 180 degrees along an axis formed by the Sun and Sagittarius A. For all of its object placements, the Master Universe Model uses specific information given in the book, as well as information reasonably surmised. To explain polar reversal, we examine Andromeda, or M31, and the Cygnus star-forming region. The intriguing topic of Andromeda's distance will not be covered here. However, revealed evidence allows the model to place Andromeda in the primary outer space level. If the galactic coordinate system did align with absolute direction, then Andromeda would be moving clockwise in the south, while we, on the super universe level, are moving counterclockwise towards the north. Presumably, moving in opposite directions would cause Andromeda to exhibit positive redshift, which it does not. However, reversing the GCS poles shows Andromeda in the east moving clockwise toward us. Toward us, that is, in its separate lane of travel. Objects moving closer exhibit a negative redshift or a blue shift, and Andromeda does show a measured blue shift. Now on to Cygnus. The Urantia book states, a sun-forming nebula just north of the borders of Orvington, but within the super-universe space level, has already given origin to approximately 40,000 suns. Research astronomers tell us this about Cygnus. The Cygnus X complex represents the most powerful star-forming region at less than 2 kiloparsecs, or nearly 6,500 light-years from us. Also that Cygnus X is the nearest massive star-forming region. Its core, Cygnus OB2, represents the most obvious example of recent star formation. Since this is the case, we can surmise the papers are referring to Cygnus as the sun-forming nebula just north of the borders of Orvington. Not only does this identify Cygnus as the likely sun-forming region, but also indicates how close Urantia is to Super Universe 1, less than 6,000 light years. The following quote contributes to this understanding. Satania is on the periphery of the local universe, and Nebadon is now well out towards the edge of Orvington. So this is why the Master Universe model reverses the GCS poles and sets the stars in the manner it does.
Thank you.
through the realization of truth. The appreciation of beauty leads to the sense of the eternal fitness of those things, which impinge upon the recognition of divine goodness in deity relations with all beings. And thus even cosmology leads to the pursuit of divine reality values, to God consciousness.
Hey, thanks, David. What started you on this path, David, to make these beautiful movies?
Well, like Philippe, I think he said that Paper 42 is really interesting to him. And the same with me. I read that paper so many times. It was just totally fascinating to me. And the cosmology of the book, really, when I was 19, that's when I started reading. And cosmology was always as interesting as reading about science in magazines or watching Nova, or, you know, I think I got more from it, the base of the Urantia book as an understanding. So that's kind of why. I've had conversations with a guy named Andre through a few of the conferences, and we always had like discussions, and I really wanted to explain things, and I don't really have the words a lot of times. And eventually it was like, well, I should just draw these things. And so I tried to learn 3D modeling long time ago, and it didn't fit into my head. I just couldn't figure it out. And then the last symposium, I did really, really try, and something clicked. You know, at some point you can really understand things, how to learn about not the cosmology so much, but the technical part of 3D graphics. And so I'm still learning all that, and putting videos together and things like that. So that's essentially why, because it's just easier to explain things when you can show things.
David has shown me some of his earliest work. And David, I am absolutely blown away by what you and Margie have done here. And you mentioned the importance of recognizing beauty. Well, you've given us a sample, in my opinion, of the real beauty of our future home. You know, this is where we can look forward to finally retiring, if you were, and going home and being in this fantastic place that is where God dwells, and where all of his best friends dwell, and where all of our best friends are going to end up. And it's just a beautiful experience for each of us to participate in this, and the music selection, and the Margie's voice is so beautiful to listen to, and it's just a wonderful experience.
Oh, I appreciate hearing that, Ralph. And
yeah,
I appreciate you being a good friend for so long.
Mm-hmm. We traveled together in Palestine back a few years ago, and we had a wonderful time.
Yeah, we do a study group as well together, and we're studying the life of Jesus, which is like on the other side of the book, but it gives you a fuller understanding of it. I'm not just like, I don't want to just concentrate only on the physical aspects of the universe, but studying the life of the master is something you really think about all the time, and just contemplate the life that he had and the life that he's given us. And it's just like a real privilege to be in that that study group that you started so long ago. You and your Betty and a few other people too.
Phil would like to make a comment.
Well, I just wanted to restate that they were great visuals and great verbal overlays, and very thoroughly enjoyable.
Oh, cool.
I wish I had more some controversy to interject, but
that's okay.
Don't.
You don't have to.
Okay. I will say this, that in the process of making this, David and I have met with a number of people that have also modeled and have been involved in many, you know, many projects, Gary Tong and Richard Jernigan and a few others. You know, the ultimate goal for as I understand in David's and my conversation is to model as much as we possibly can. And you may not have exactly appreciated it yet, but the thing about the software that David is using in Blender is how scalable it is. Unlike models in the past, the ability to scale only when he did the pullback, did you begin to get an idea of the scale. Now, we did the, you know, 1:10 to 100 ratio, or he did, on what we saw. Now, you know, what unit you want to put on that, light year or megaparsecs or whatever, that's your choice. But ultimately, David wants to model everything down to planets and architectural worlds, particularly architectural worlds, and place them so it can be a learning thing. And Gary Tong used a word to us that really kind of blew us both away. He said, "You want to gamify it." And we were like, yeah, we want people to be able themselves to go into it and explore, you know, and look around and do things with it. And so we were both very taken with that, you know, with that idea. And ultimately, I think David will, you know, will get there. It's it's been a privilege to be a part of it. So
yeah, as far as that goes, I've seen some really good software that does astronomy, where you can see so many of the stars. You just click on the most obscure star, and it gives you all of the data that they have about it. Some of them, they go to a Wikipedia article and tell you, you know, the details of that particular sphere, you know, that sun. And the other one is the anatomy program called Complete Anatomy. And it's used in schools to teach people. And this, so how would you use that for this would be, so you see the, like the paradise worlds, you can click on a paradise world and get the Urantia book information about everything we know about that particular sphere, you know? Other things too. I think it would be kind of cool. In fact, it's very simple from the model as it is now to do like a 3D, you know, virtual reality presentation. I have tried it, and it's the resolution isn't that great, but I think that's getting better. And it would be kind of cool to fly around the universe. We're going to do it anyway, but I did sort of simulate it.
Very good.
Okay, Conrad's got his hand up.
Hey, Conrad.
And congratulations for that. That's absolutely beautiful presentation, by the way. Something that drew my attention, and I'm very curious about, is this outer space levels. I noticed 1 trillion light years, and I don't know if it was 100 or 1,000 trillion light years. That's fairly large. How did you come to those numbers?
It's based on the 1-to-100 pattern that I think we find in paper, I think it's paper 12, section 1. And it's sort of what I also picked up from listening to Bill Sadler Jr.'s talks and reading his book. It's in line with what he says. He used analogies, starting with like a tennis ball, and then it ended up being something bigger than the moon for the each outer space level, how big the next one is. So if we go with 1 million light years across for the super universe level, 1 million light years transverse diameter, multiply that by 100, multiply that by 100, you know, out, and it came to be 100 trillion light years from paradise. That, you know, so 200 trillion across. I think that's what it was. Yeah, we'll have to check the details of that, but it seems that it coincided with the study of the master universe from what Bill Sadler wrote.
Fairly large, to say the least, eh?
Pretty big. Yep. And so that, you know, the where you see the respiration out to that level, I think the revelators say that there's speculation. They don't know a lot. They use the term "we do not know" quite a bit, but they talk. They speculate like we do, and they say some people say that this is as big as it's going to get. You know, and then some people say, well, if it's connected to God and it's connected to paradise, then there's no limit to its how big that can be.
So the
what you're seeing with that respiration may be considered to be the core of infinity.
Okay, Andre's got his hand up.
Hey, Andre.
Well done, David and Margie. Good work. It's really wonderful. Every visualization, I think, that comes about gives us new information, a new understanding. And just to clarify, you know, what you were indicating there, when you're saying 100 trillion light years out at the fourth outer space level, that's including the buffer zone, the semi-quiet zone outside of it. So it would take it to like 50 that's trillion. So, and, you know, 50 million light years for the first outer space level with 50, like, and that's all Sadler's idea. So I have a question for you on that, because I've been doing this kind of thinking myself.
Yeah, and your videos are also very outstanding.
Oh, it's kind of you to say, thank you. The issue for me right now, you know, given how we measure, you know, stellar distances, the fact that the furthest quasars and galaxies and whatnot are on that edge of 13.8 billion light years away, and we're looking there, and we know that 13.8 billion light years, according to Sadler's model, would take us into the third outer space level. That's where that would be going, right?
If the numbers are right, yeah.
If the numbers are right, exactly. So my question is, you know, is your thought that the stellar distances are exaggerated on the part of astronomy, that we're still looking within the second outer space level, or would you? I'll leave it at that for right now.
It's a really interesting topic. The first,
maybe let me just add one thing.
Yeah.
The semi-quiet zone of 5 billion light years does the astronomical data corroborate that we seem to have an empty 5 billion light year gap somewhere? Or has Sadler perhaps underestimated the size of the second outer space level?
From what I understand, the measurements to the galaxies and these galactic walls are based entirely, I mean, pretty much entirely on the distance to Andromeda. And we all know Hubble said it was under a million light years, and that coincides with the Urantia book. And that was the standard thought up until like 1950. And this information actually comes from a book called The Universe by Isaac Asimov, published in 1966. It's the only information I could find about like a history of the distance to Andromeda. And at first it was very, you know, when they first made estimations, very, very close, you know, and eventually Hubble used the Cepheid variables and measured the distance to the Magellanic clouds and to Andromeda, because there was an opportunity with a supernova explosion out there. So that was under 1 million light years was the standard until 1950. And the astronomers were uncomfortable with that, because if it was that close, then Andromeda is really small. It's so much smaller, a third smaller, a fourth smaller. And the astronomers would say, why should this? I mean, and they were measuring that and saying every other galaxy beyond it was also small. But why should all these galaxies be smaller than the Milky Way? They didn't have the information that we have, but there was somebody that came up with, well, there's two kinds of Cepheid variables. One is the one that they use to measure the Magellanic clouds, which is what they use to measure Andromeda. But there's also measuring Cepheids that are in the deep dust clouds of the Milky Way, you know, near the zone of avoidance. They said, well, if we use that number, then Andromeda is actually bigger than the Milky Way. And all of these other galaxies are also bigger than the Milky Way. And they liked that. So that's what they went with. And I'm not saying absolutely that this is the case, that Andromeda is really closer and within a million light years. But it's really worth looking into. So if you're scientists, why don't we study what if Andromeda really was at this 800, 900,000 light year distance beyond the semi-quiet zone? What if it was that small and all these other galaxies were that small and closer? Do they then fit into these galactic walls, then fit into the regions of lessened resistance to motion between the semi-quiet zones? So it's an interesting story, and that it's the only place I saw it. So I think it's worth researching, you know.
Thank you. Yeah. It's an interesting question.
Hey, Phil.
But they are seeing, you know, they are mapping. This reason we said in the thing, the mapping of voids, where there's literally nothing. Okay. And it'll be interesting to have a model that if you map those on, do they also, you know, and a lot of the things that they're seeing now, when you map them on the model, if they like in unpervaded space, you know, somewhere that they just really can't be, then the model has to be, adjusted, or we come up with some other better
explanation.
Yeah, of what's actually going on. I think Phil wanted to make a comment.
Yeah,
I just wanted to point out that later we realized that Andromeda was about 3 times bigger than they thought. Some outlying areas that they thought were just background stars or something turns out to be part of Andromeda. So they had to revise its size. So it's interesting, you were saying that they thought it was too small. Now it's apparently at least as big, maybe bigger than they thought in the beginning. Maybe 9 times as big.
Well, I have a question for you, Phil, or anyone. How do you think this semi-quiet zone, which has resistance to motion and doesn't have cosmic dust, does that have an effect on the measurements? Does it even, they say it has an anti-gravity effect. So we know about gravitational lensing. Is there possibly like this wide angle gravitational lensing that this might have?
I don't have any thought of or knowledge about that particularly, David. It's an interesting question. Can we be getting gravitational lensing effects there? I guess they understand usually when that's occurring because they have some information, but the stars move so slowly. How do they actually know it's gravitational lensing or just something else?
Well, there was an interesting thing I read recently. In fact, it was there's a guy named Anton Petrov who's on the YouTube, and he has. He puts out these brilliant videos like almost every day about cosmology and science. Yeah. And so he talked about this. Remember when they had the first photograph of a black hole, but it turns out it's really not a photograph of the black hole. It's an assembly of information that they put together over time from different observatories. And it turned out it looked like what they wanted it to look like. But I think Japanese researchers took a look at the data and they said, well, they're making a lot of assumptions. But the assumption that they were making was if you make it if instead of using the angle of observation, if you widened it like a wide angle lens, then it doesn't look like that picture anymore, but it shows all of this extra data about what's emerging from this this black hole that they're studying. So there is some interesting stuff going on.
We do have some questions. There's it says, on your model, I see more of an oval pill-shaped paradise, or paradise is definitely ellipsoid. Perhaps you can show a picture, David, about why that shows how you rendered paradise the way it is or whatever, if you want to do that.
Oh, yeah, if I could find it. I thought for sure I had that.
Now, they specifically say that paradise is 6 by 7 by 1/6,
and that's what that's the dimensions that David rendered.
Yeah, George, that is the dimensions, but I do have slight curvature in the east and west, not as much as a full mathematical ellipse, and I'm going in part by the when they talk about the pattern of paradise, and they talk about the way that the super universes move in their circulation around paradise, that they mention the word comparative straightaway, right?
Yeah.
And they mentioned it twice on the one side and the other side. So there's like not a straightaway, it's not an exact line, but there's some curvature. And also Bill Sadler Jr. did that drawing, and it was using that kind of information too. So I think maybe like when they say ellipse or elliptical, or they're sort of meaning like ellipse-like.
Yeah, they say ellipsoid. They don't say an ellipse. They say ellipsoid. Okay,
yeah,
that
like
means that it has the shape of an ellipse. But when they're saying that it's, you know, that we're on the northern straightaway, it's sort of like there's got to be, it's that. And so, you know,
and they use
that
phrase like twice. So
yeah,
really,
I think the rationale is okay, but not to say that,
yeah,
you know, somebody else will certainly draw it.
Exactly.
You know,
yeah.
Draw
I mean,
it
this isn't the be all and end all. It's like, you got to draw the line somewhere if you're a cartographer. So,
right.
Plant your flags. Plus, and they use the word sphere for the Earth too, but the Earth isn't a sphere, is it? You know, it's a spheroid, I think. So,
oblate.
Well, yeah, but they don't say that.
No.
It's convenience, I think, to make it, you know, easy to understand.
Okay.
So,
Phil.
and it very well could be a perfect ellipse too. It's just, it's a choice.
I think they specifically say about Orvantan and the super universes that they are spokes. They refer to them as spokes, on the wheel that has the outer space levels, but the super universes are shaped as spokes. And the reason for that, of course, is that they get close to Havona, and then, you know, that means they're moving faster in terms of their rotation. And then when they come out, they're spreading out further. And they say that there's more overlap close to Havona, and outside, you know, they spread out more. So I'm seeing it more like a long ellipsoid,
mm-hmm.
wider on the outside than it is inside close to Havona.
Yeah,
I always think about
it like a
fan blade, you know, like your fan, the old fan, you know, it's
fan, right,
closer to the thing. Blade. It's narrower, but then it goes out like that, you know. So I, you know, when they say that, it's like it's a fan that has seven blades to it, you know, and they're, that's
like
kind
that.
Of the way I've always thought of it.
Yeah, and it isn't, they aren't round.
No, they're
round at all.
Yeah. Conrad.
We often hear about the dark gravity bodies surrounding Havona and the Isle of Paradise. I wonder if there is any astronomical hint pointing to some sort of great wall or something like that that would at least reveal an area where we're not getting anything, because nothing comes through this set of those dark gravity bodies.
Well, one intriguing part is the Fermi bubbles that they've mapped. They assume that it's coming from the center of the Milky Way galaxy, but we, as your ANSA students, know that that's only pointing in the direction of the dark gravity bodies, and they're putting out a lot of energy, that energy of an up-down nature, wave-like form energy. So if you go beyond where they say it is, then it's farther away and it's bigger, and it might look like what we see in the artist conceptions of the Fermi bubbles. And the actual data that they published.
We have a few other, let me do two questions from our audience. One is from Gaetan, and it said, David, you mentioned in your presentation that the study of cosmology is conducive to God consciousness. Could you explain in which way it does without falling into an intellectual trap?
Oh, don't worry about that. I'm not capable of that, but it's about beauty, I think. It's about knowledge of accuracy and truth. And studying cosmology is studying why the cosmology even happened. And that's leading you to the one who made it happen.
We also have a question from David Henry, which is, what are your thoughts about the strange comment about the super universes being closer to paradise in the east-west positions?
Well, yeah, and they are, some super universes are going to be closer than others. And I think maybe they're going by the centers, you know, like Uversa and the capitals of the other super universes. They approach closer when you're on that relative straightaway than when you're in the southern and the northern regions. So I think that's probably how I would understand it.
We have a question from Rick Warren. Do you know how far in light years it is from Uversa to the outer edge of Havona?
The outer edge of Havona. I think Phil would roughly, he estimate, what did you say, Phil? I mean, I put it like half a
Well, I think it's a little less. I think that they say that from Uversa to
400 million.
I think it's 250,000 light years or 300. It's in that range.
Right.
Yeah, I think so too. And I think that because they give us all this oddly specific information, we can probably use like redshift for finding more about Andromeda. And if we have to like make assumptions as to whether the Uversa is always in a constant orbit or is that participating in the space respiration as well. So if that's the case, then Uversa would be variable distance from the central creation. But it very well could be on a straight path, just like the Orvantan sphere of the spirit worlds of the paradise worlds.
Andre's got his hand up.
You know, the dark gravity bodies, they say they're non-reactive to physical energy light. That really means that as far as we're concerned, as far as our physics is concerned, probably they're transparent to light. They don't say transparent. They don't say that there's retransmission. They say non-reactive. That seems to be even better than anything that's transparent, that's material. It's as though it's not there. And so what I've wondered, and I think your idea is interesting about the Fermi bubbles, but it is curious that they're right in the center of the Milky Way. And alternatively, I've wondered whether the Fermi bubbles are indicative of the Uversa power centers doing their stuff, and somehow the way they handle energy would actually create these. And for those that don't know, the Fermi bubbles are, you know, emitting gamma rays and X-rays that are 25,000 light years tall, you know, above and below. So 50,000 light years. Well, what's very interesting about that is, let's say they are indicators of that major architectural sphere of the energy going in from Paradise and Avona to Uversa and going out, and somehow the way it's handled there.
Well, what's
been interesting to me as a possibility for the Fermi bubbles is that should we decide to go looking for Fermi bubbles in roughly the direction that they should be in for the other super universes, we may actually be able to determine where the center of the other six super universes are by virtue of looking at these essentially torches.
Like maybe with the web information.
Exactly, yeah. So that's an interesting one. As far as the dark gravity bodies, we're not likely to be able to see them, but in terms of how thick they are, have you calculated as well that they're probably very narrow bands?
Yeah.
They're probably not more than about 50 light years in transverse diameter, and the inner one probably 300.
Yeah, that's actually pretty modelable because they give us really specific information. But the thing about that, the dark gravity bodies, is that they're in, look, how many suns are there putting out light? And where is that light going? You know, some of it's going out toward the outer space levels, but a lot of it has to be like curving back in towards Paradise. And it's like those solar generators that have many, many mirrors, they're all putting light into one particular spot. And all of this light of the super universes and the outer space levels, well, maybe half of it is coming back in towards the dark gravity bodies. They can't go, they're doing something. There's some kind of maybe a catalyst or something that's energizing.
They're like solar collectors, basically,
Something. They say they're
non-reactive.
Right.
It goes through, like I think you're saying they go through. So
that would be an indication. Just one other idea that really confuses the whole thing for all of us. We really don't have an answer as to what the boundaries, the upper boundaries of space, of pervaded space, are doing. So in the Maltese cross, upper and lower, what happens to physical energy, light, and other energy when it encounters that? It clearly can't be allowed to go into mid-space, okay? Even less so from there into unpervaded space. Right. So if it's reaching a boundary, what's it doing? Is it reflecting? Is it being channeled somewhere? Is it being absorbed? And those are questions that we have to ask about the nature of that, because we may actually be looking at galaxies, quasars, and whatnot way out there that are being reflected in the upper and lower reaches of the boundaries of pervaded space.
That's really interesting.
Right. Phil's got his hand up.
There is that great attractor that has been identified gravitationally, although they can't see anything there, which is corresponds to the dark gravity body that the two regions are close to just outside of Havona, and so those areas don't have to be very big. Of course, they go up and down, and I finally have a sense of the dark gravity bodies. He says they're tubular, and then the up and down is 10,000 times the height of the inside region, and the transverse is 50,000 times the diameter of the inner region. But that's, you know, 50,000 times whatever the other dimension is. But here's something that struck me as I was doing my paper, and I haven't had a chance to mention it. How big is paradise? Well, we're told that the inner circuit can go all the way around in 1,000 years of our years. So that all the way around must be at no more than 1,000 light years. In fact, probably maybe 1/10 of that. So now we're talking about.
I don't think we can make that assumption.
Well, all right.
It's Havona.
Let me finish. So I mean, if it goes, if the inner circuit circulates paradise in 1,000 years, little less. That inner circuit is not going any faster than speed of light. It's in space. So anyway, that's my calculation. However, I don't think that paradise is only in that one place. I think that there's an elastic presence of it. So it's just above space. No matter where space is, another paradise is just above it. So I'm not saying that all of a sudden we can localize it and completely there. But at least it says that there is a sense in which macroscopically, apparently, it's only, you know, 1,000 light years or less around. Well, we've been talking about 50,000, 100,000 million light years. And here we have something that, you know, the inner circuit can go around in less than 1,000 years. So that seems like a significant point.
Well, I do have a discovery that I did make, and I have the exact number that the size of paradise is one paradise wide. It's the standard measurement.
Yeah, that doesn't tell us anything, though.
The idea, I think we restrict things a little too much if we decide that super universe level and outer space level which we know is not part of the Havona system of energy, is limited to the speed of light of that particular system. If we make that assumption, then we may be making incorrect assumptions about how Havona was actually eternalized. For one thing, it was eternalized. And there's, as crazy as it is, I mean, let's just take this. Let's say the worlds are going around at 1/10 of the speed of light. That's nuts. Okay. How do angels land on that? How do they do any of that? How do celestial beings deal with that at all? So whether it's 1/10 of the speed of light or 10 times the speed of light, there has to be something different going on in terms of how beings transport, what they do, what's going on there. The point being, we can't necessarily use the standards of the super universe space level and, you know, segregata, as was stated earlier in an earlier paper, right? And all of that kind of energy versus the, you know, trinary kind of Havona energy and what the speed of Havona light might be. It's a different kind of light.
Well, Havona is in space.
Pardon?
I said the space bodies of Havona, the seven circuits, are in space. They say that.
They are. They are in space. That's that. So whatever limitation that would provide, and I don't want to commandeer this, you know, but I agree, it's a problem, but we ought not to limit our thinking based on things like the speed of light.
Yeah, Havona is a different story in a way because of the position between the dark gravity bodies in the massive pile of paradise.
Right. So.
We have a question from Mark French, which I think we can answer here to a degree. Do you believe we are allowed to view paradise? If not, what technique would be in place to serve as a shield? My first answer is dark gravity bodies, but go for it, guys.
No, they say otherwise.
Right. They say not, but he wanted to know what would be the shield that would prevent us from seeing paradise. And I said, my vote's on dark gravity bodies, but the rest of y'all come up with your idea, you know?
No, I think that's something we'll have to wait to see personally at some point.
Well, I think they say that, and I think somebody, was it you, Andre, who said that these dark gravity bodies don't react to light. So therefore, light seems to either go right around them, and so you see what's behind them, you don't see them, and that they're therefore shrouded from even the close by passage of the bodies in the super universes. Even when they're close passing by, they don't see anything because it's shrouded by the dark gravity bodies, which I think means that you just see right through them or around them without knowing that. I guess that would be gravitational lensing.
So it's like the invisibility cloak for Havona, yes. Right? Okay, now then, we got the
Harry Potter's got nothing. Harry Potter's got nothing on
the right, board. Right. Not even close. So I think Scott Forrester asks, light is EM radiation, convection and connection or heat requires mass. So God has mass.
Well, the first source and center is not only the source of spirit, but also the source of matter and energy. So, you know, God has it all. In him, all things consist.
And the same applies to our thought adjuster as well, pure spirit and pure energy.
Mm-hmm. And direct line without worrying about gravity. I mean, it's just that's, well, there's gravity. It's a personality gravity, is it?
Yeah.
I've got a comment for Andre. Andre, this is from Paul Anderson. It says, Andre Redatus, I like the way you think. In Havona, distances may take on new meaning. We will be spiritual beings, so a spiritual reality around us may allow for instantaneous travel.
And the worlds are close to each other, too. They're daisy chained, you know.
Yeah, you ought to see the way David has modeled the billion worlds.
Beautiful.
It's they're gorgeous. It's like these strings of beautiful pearls. He's actually color coded the spirits, and like for our universe, it's white because we're Father, Son, and you know we're all three. But he gave color to all of them. But as the Havona worlds go by, they color based on what spirit their opposite, you know? Oh. And so it looks it's so cool. It's like so really neat. So he'll show you that one next time, but that one's, it's pretty. It's really pretty.
Well, I agree with you, Andre. I think that the Havona worlds are also close because they're all orderly. They don't need to be far away from each other.
Right. Even if we take into account gravity tidal friction and they're mitigating against that, they could be 2.5 radii apart and daisy chained that far apart.
Hollow. Aren't they hollow? They're constructed.
We don't know about Havona worlds, how they're constructed, but we do know that the infinite spirit made it, and the infinite spirit also is in charge of anti-gravity. So all bets are off in terms of how they could be constructed. But it's clear that the architectural worlds must be, especially considering what our good friend George Park was indicating about gravity and the inside of a sphere. That was very, very interesting, how gravity diminishes, you know, on the inside of a sphere, of a hollow sphere, and some of the physics.
That's all in Newton's mechanics. Right. I remember reading about that, that inside it follows that law.
Thank you, Conrad, Phil, Andre, and my partner, David,